Historical Society on BCTV is supported in part by the Highlands at Wyomissing.
Hello and welcome to the monthly program of the Historical Society of Berks County. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, President of the Historical Society of Berks County and publisher of the Historical Review of Berks County, the Society's quarterly magazine published continuously since October of 1935. Not incidentally, most back issues of our review are still available from the 1930s up to the present time. It should be noted that this program is telecast live on the first Wednesday of each month at 7. It repeats this Friday at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Welcome all to our June 2009 program. Seated beside me is Joshua Blay, Society Curator and Associate Director.
Good evening, George.
Good evening. Beside Joshua is Simon B. Bertlett, the Society's Executive Director.
Good evening, George.
Good evening. Beside Mr. Bertlett is Bob Cooper, who's widely known as the Director of Musicals and Similar Entertainments.
Good evening. Thank you for having me.
Our pleasure. And anchoring our panel is Fred Sheeler, Recorder of Deeds for Berks County, whose accomplishments in that office, are worthy of recognition.
Oh, thank you very much.
We thank you for appearing on our program.
Our Henry Johnson Library, Museum, and Gift Shop are open Tuesday through Saturday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Please check our website for holiday closings. The next one's going to be July 4th, where it will be closed Saturday, and we'll close it Friday, 2 o'clock in the afternoon beforehand. Our museum shop is fully stocked with Reading and Berks histories by a variety of present-day and old-time authors. Our gift shop has the largest inventory to be found locally of Reading and Berks County histories, new and pre-owned. Right now, we have a fresh supply of back issues of The Passing Scene. I actually did a count here. This is probably going to be easier to say what we don't have, but we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, 10, and 12 for sale, in addition to the regularly carried 13, 15, and 60. We also have a wide variety of pottery, artwork, and craft items by a number of local artisans and potters.
You know, was it 2 days ago? Was it yesterday? Was it Saturday? We had some 7s and 11s, which are very hard to get.
Yeah, those are I think those are the ones that go for like umpteen dollars on eBay, if I remember correctly.
They do. We remind viewers that for $40 a year, you can be one of us, a member of the Historical Society of Berks County. Membership in the Society includes our prize-winning quarterly magazine, The Historical Review of Berks County. Membership includes unlimited use of the museum and library. Incidentally, family memberships, all those living in the same house, are $50 a year.
And while we're on the subject of memberships, we remind you that Berks Community TV, BCTV, is a survivor and a tough venue and unique entity in that it's interactive. You are encouraged to call in with your questions and comments to 610-378-0426.
So why not salute BCTV for all the great shows it provides to Reading and Berks and send a check for $30 for a year's membership. Mail your check to BCTV, 645 Penn Street, Reading 19601. Remember, time passes, but operating expenses never go away. Simon, I have a last-minute announcement. I'm going to stick in right here. I just got a phone call as I was leaving the house.
Okay.
From our good friend Earl Eibach from Wummelsdorf. He tells us that on Saturday, June the 27th, they're going to have a church tour, 14 churches. And the tour runs from 4 to 9 o'clock. It's one of those things, I guess, that you tour on your own. All the churches involved start with Wernersville, and they run westward up into Lebanon, I think. I know that they're going to be in Newmanstown and Richland. $15 if you get tickets on the day of... Excuse me, $15 if you get tickets prior to the day of the event, $20 on the day of the tour. That is Saturday, June the 27th. And if you have any questions concerning this church tour, call, look at the phone book and check for the Talpahuckan Settlement Historical Society in Wummelsdorf. Talk to somebody there and you can arrange for tickets. 14 churches. Okay, Simon.
Okay. Well, you heard Josh and George talking about the passing scene. Well, I have it on good authority that we can anticipate another passing scene, volume 17, to be released mid to late November, just in time for the holidays. And naturally, we'll be also be having and hosting an autograph party at the Historical Society where George and Gloria will sign your copies of The Passing Scene, new volume 17, probably the first weekend or two in December. So you want to put that on your calendars. It's going to be the same great book as it always is, 272 heavy hardbound book, 272 heavy stock paper with pictures that have never been seen before. So make a note on your calendar. Also, Josh mentioned that we still do have copies of Passing Scene volumes 15 and 16, but as I've told you a number of times before, that this is going to be a one run and one run only, so there's going to be no reprints. When these are gone, they're gone. So I urge you, get to the Historical Society, pick up your copy before they're all sold out. Copies sell for $45, and that is tax included. And I believe I also heard that the next volume 17 is going to be at the same price.
Yeah, so it's not bad when you consider inflation over the past 3 or 4 years.
And it'll probably contain 350 photographs.
350 photographs. Mm-hmm. And a full index, like
old. And a full index.
You bet.
We're fully aware that many of our home viewers really like to see old-time views of Reading and Berks. It's this aspect of our show that sets the Historical Society's monthly presentation apart from all other programs on local cable. In a few minutes, we'll begin the first of two segments of old-time local photographs. But first, Sime?
Well, I'd like to talk right now about an event we usually we hold every year, and that's our annual, what I call our Friendraiser fundraiser. When we do these friendraising dinners, we always try to tie them to the theme of our current exhibit. Our current exhibit now is entitled On the Berks Home Front, We Stood United, World Wars I and II. And again, this year we are doing a friend-raising event, and it will follow the theme of that exhibit. It's going to be held on Wednesday evening, June 17th, from 6 p.m. to around 9:30, 10 o'clock. It's going to be held at the Abraham Lincoln, and we're also going to be using it to, these events fund the youth and adult education programs the Historical Society puts on. There'll be a cocktail reception starting at 6 o'clock. It'll go till about 7:15 when we'll all be seated for dinner, and then after dinner we're going to have the program of the evening. And this year it's going to be great because, again, as with the On the Home Front theme, it's going to be a USO extravaganza. And we also have with us Bob Cooper, which I'll be talking to you here in a second. But I'd like to also mention the tickets for this event are $100. $70 of that is tax deductible, and as I said, proceeds go to fund the youth education programs from the Historical Society. This evening also wouldn't have been possible were it not for the generous contribution, underwriting contribution, of a number of firms in the area, and I'd like to recognize them now. The first one I'd like to recognize as the Triple E Award sponsor is the Spinnaker Foundation. Additional help was provided by Phoebe Berks Village, Weidenhammer, William G. Cuck & Associate, the Gerald Lynn Foundation, F.M. Brown Sons, and also the Historical Society of Berks County Auxiliary. We'd really like to say a great big thanks to them for all the help that they have been in helping us put on this friend-raising event. But now I'd like to turn to Bob Cooper, who is the director of the Reading Civic Theater, and he's going to tell us a little bit about the evening, what we can install. And this is going to be news to me because this is a total surprise. They kept this under wraps, and like I said, it's going to be a great time. Bob, why don't you tell us a little bit about
it? Well, thank you very much, Simon. We're very excited to be a part of this evening. There are two basic functions of the evening. One is to have a whole heck of a lot of fun. And the other, obviously, is to try to bring to this event some really top-notch talent, and I think we've succeeded in that. We are bringing forth a few stars from Reading Civic Theater over the years. Brian Smith will be performing and singing. Now, Brian played the Beast in Beauty and the Beast, and was absolutely phenomenal. He also was one of the leads in The Scarlet Pimpernel, Joseph in The Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. He's one of our top-notch folks, and we're excited to have him participate in this event. And then we're going to be doing some songs, big band songs from the 40s. We were just rehearsing last night, as a matter of fact, and we had a great time with a few of the guys.
Okay.
We were there.
A few of the band
night.
Members? Or
no,
the
we were, a few of the cast.
Okay.
A few of the cast. Also joining us will be Maria DeMoor. Now, Maria DeMoor is also a longtime star of Reading Civic Theater, as well as many local bands that have performed throughout the eastern United States. She's very talented. She is going to be performing a few tunes. Now, she's done Evita with Reading Civic Theater. She played Evita, the starring role. She's been in Sweeney Todd.
Van Perez.
Evita Perón.
Evita Perón, excuse
me. Yes. So she'll be joining us. Also with us will be my brother, who is Kevin Cooper, the music director, longtime music director for Reading Civic Theater, who's worked with me and started many shows with Reading Civic Theater as well. And Jen Parker Scott, who's been in quite a few of our shows as well. Lots of great vocal talent. So we're looking forward to that. But, you know, when we talked about doing this, Simon, we're talking about big band era music.
Yeah. That's,
so, you know, okay. It's hard to do that with the piano, right?
Right.
So we hired one of the best big bands in the area. We've got Dave Stahl coming.
Ooh.
Dave Stahl's band, I should say. Not Dave himself, but the band itself, which is just incredible band. I heard them play a month and a half ago, and it was just amazing.
How many pieces in the band?
13.
Okay. Pieces. All right.
So it's got that real big band feel to it. It's got full winds, four saxes, three trumpets, rhythm section, two trombones. It's a big sound.
Now, when they when we're on the music, is it gonna be all vocals? Gonna be vocal skits?
No, there'll be some vocals. There'll be some instrumental.
Okay.
There'll be some dancing.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, we're hoping at the end to get some of you guys out and come dance with us to the big band music.
Well, I can promise you, Jill and I will do that.
Fantastic. We're gonna do some Glenn Miller standards with it.
All right.
So you know, if you like dancing to In the Mood, you're gonna have that opportunity.
Any Artie Shaw?
Oh my gosh, we got some Artie Shaw.
Oh boy.
There.
All right.
Begin to begin. We got some good stuff.
Some Benny Goodman?
Some Benny Goodman. Some Benny Goodman. Lots of good stuff.
Hey, that sounds great. This is going to be a fun evening. And, the reviews that I've gotten when I've talked to people and said, you know, Reading Civic is going to be part of this and the Dave Stahl Orchestra, and they said, you know, they couldn't believe it. They said, this really should be a fun time. So, I just encourage everybody, if you're, you know, looking to have a really good time, give us a call at the Historical Society, 610-375-4375, ask for Gloria Miser, and, just tell her you want tickets for the On the Berks Homefront USO Extravaganza, and we'll get you set up. It's, like I said, this just sounds like a really wonderful evening, and we're just so happy and really thankful that you all could do this and you would help us out on this.
I think you guys are going to have a great time. I know we're going to have a great time. This is wonderful music that you don't often get a chance to hear a good big band play, the 40s style music. So I think that's fascinating. And at this level, these are guys who have played in Broadway in New York, played all over New York, as a matter of fact. So this is a very talented orchestra. And the performers, the vocal performers, are just top-notch. So we're all in for a great evening, and we hope we see all of you there.
What's that date?
Wednesday, June 17th, 2009, 6 p.m. begins at the Abraham Lincoln Hotel. So, like I said, give us a call to the Historical Society, 610-375-4375, and we can get you set up.
That isn't all that far from now.
No, it's not.
It's
only 2 weeks from today. So, you need to hurry up. The tickets are selling very quickly, and like I said, we don't want to... don't want you to get left out. It really will be a good time.
Yeah, thank you, Bob.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you very, very much.
It's a pleasure. Look forward to seeing you in a couple of weeks.
You bet. And we'll probably be talking. Josh and I are planning an exhibit for next year that will probably need something on the guys and dolls theme.
So, fantastic.
Anyway,
we won't tell you. Great show.
All right.
Thanks for having me.
Very much.
All right.
Appreciate it.
Well, let's take a little break at this time and have some slides. Okay. Well, let's see. We're going to start off in Penn Street.
Ding, ding.
Yeah, that's for sure. Looking down from, from Pomeroy's store. Notice how the cars were always parked on the diagonal on Penn Square. We're looking down to 4th and Penn, to the restaurant that still is there. The Reading Times was published out of that building very, very early. Like 1850, in the 1850s, 57, 58. On the right-hand side, you'll see part of what had been the Crystal Restaurant Complex that burned quite a number of years ago. I think we had seen this once before. We're going to take another quick look at it. That's the old Eagles building right near City Park. And the right-hand side going up, it would be the 1000 block. This building was torn down a long time ago, before they had even started working on restoring the pagoda, because they wanted to put those lights that you see on the outside of the building up at the pagoda. We took them down one night, and the next day, that same night, someone swiped them, and those lights never got to up to the pagoda. The old Eagles. On the roof of that building was that. And that always surprises people to see that that band shell on top of the Eagles building, because they used to have dancing up there at night. With big bands, I guess. Yeah. And looking in the way in the background, we see the collapsible or the expandable gas tank, which was part of the Reading Gas Company or the UGI years ago. They always told the story about watching that thing. They would manufacture gas and before the dinner hour, and as they would manufacture gas, the top of that thing would go up. And as people would be cooking, it would work its way down. So they had two tanks down there, one stationary, oh, that's very good. And the other one, the expandable gas tank. What happened to those? Tropical Storm Magnus in 1972 took care of those tanks. Can we pan over and get to the left a little bit to show that van shell on the roof of the old Eagles? Yeah, there we are. Now, there were two of those that were in Reading. The other one was at the Elks. Now, I haven't been on the roof of the Elks, so I have no idea where that van shell is up there anymore. I tend to doubt it, but
sure.
Elks, yeah.
Say again, what was the street address on that one?
It would be the 1000 block of Penn Street. It was the Eagles. They used to have bingo there in the last days that the building existed.
So on a nice summer evening, they have a big band in there. There's dancing out there. They're under the stars. You can turn around. You can see the pagoda.
Oh, yeah.
And you can see Neversink Mountain. You probably could be able to see it. That would be a really neat
time.
That
was neat.
Oh.
That was a great building.
That's amazing.
Oh, I wonder how high those guardrails are.
Well, it depends on how you guys are going to say. Yeah.
Looking at those as that a building appeared in the last days, I would take hate to have a little stroller up there pushing it around. It could be. Anyhow, the building was torn down, unfortunately. That's been gone quite a long time ago. I used to play bingo up there. Okay, we're on South 4th Street. There's the little old log cabin that today actually is alongside Cherry, but in that time you had a double building to the left, and then you had Cherry Street on the right-hand side. When they widened Cherry Street, those buildings were taken away. That is now, is that, but that's the Speckled Hen, or
Speckled Hen, yeah, and Judy's is right behind
it. Judy's back, is right behind it, the old Market House building. Yeah, those two buildings were torn away. In the one building on the left-hand side, Ben Austrian's people had lived for a while, and they formed Temple Oheb Shalom in that building on the left-hand side, the white double property. Crystal Palace hot dog place. Crystal Palace, of course, moved over to South 6th Street, where it is today, and is one of the very popular places in Reading to get a hot dog. The hot dogs are as good now as they were 50 years ago. One of our favorite haunts.
No burgers.
Oh, yes.
No burgers.
No burgers anymore, but great hot dogs. The old Crystal Palace was right next to the Astor Theater. As a matter of fact, it was in, that was the old Crystal Market House, and there was a Crystal Hotel in the upper floors. They called it the Crystal because it had so much glass. And again, the Astor Theater, 734 Penn, was to the immediate right of that picture. The interior of the Crystal, and I can remember the one fellow who worked there used to have those hot dogs all lined up in his arm all the way up, and those chairs that you see partially on the right-hand side, those still exist down there at South 6th. I remember looking at this picture not too awful long ago, and that in the back you see that looks like a bottle made out of metal. That was sort of in the shape of a Moxie bottle, and that was where you got your cold sodas. That, but they closed that building down, and they tore it away. That soda cooler disappeared because that's no longer around.
Probably in somebody's basement bar.
Yes, I mean, that's possible, yeah. They used to be open all hours of the day and night. You could go there for a hot dog almost any time. Very, very rare picture. This would be at Hockley Lane and Schuylkill Avenue, later renamed West Elm Street. We would be looking, Schuylkill Avenue would be on the, Schuylkill Avenue would be in the background, and this would be West Elm Street here on the right-hand side. Peter Barbie started making his beer on Penn Street at 6th and Penn, and they had a vault here in the side of the hill. And later on they moved, they were only there in Penn Street a very short time, and they moved over here and built their brewery and incorporated that vault. Oftentimes, I was just thinking that whole hillside has been sort of scooped away and changed. I wonder whatever happened to that vault that used to be there. I'm just sort of thinking about that now. I can't quite picture, there is no West Elm Street anymore, because when they worked on the Reading's waterfront in that general section and cleared everything away. Now, to the rear of that would be Barbie's playground. I guess Barbie's is still there, I think.
The playground.
The playground.
Yeah.
Okay. It's been a long time since I was there, truthfully.
I wonder how many people who go to Barbie's playground recognize the significance of the name.
Probably
not.
I
bet not many at all.
Not many. John Barbie had a wonderful mansion on Center Avenue right across from our Hendel House, torn down years ago, and today that's a park. That was John Barbie, his son. John
Barbie from Vanity Fair.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now that gives you a better picture of that old brewery. Now, when you look at that picture, the brewery that most of us remember didn't look quite like that. It was rebuilt. But we would be looking up West Elm Street, originally Hockley Lane, and looking towards Schuylkill Avenue, which at this time was Kissinger Lane. Pomeroy's, as it appeared after it was sort of modernized, at least the two lower levels, designed by the Muhlenbergs, those changes were effected in the 1950s. The building itself in the corner was erected in the year 1900. At the top of that building, some of you people might remember, there was a sign on the Penn Street side at the very top that said Heisman Building. And we had that sign at the Historical Society
behind
the streetcar, right, behind the horse car. And on the other side of the street, where the cigar store was, we see the sign for the Sunshine Beer.
Speaking of Barbie's.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you're right, Barbie's Sunshine. And of course, at the other end of the square was the old Reading Beer sign at 4th on the same side of the street. Pomeroy's was Reading's largest department store. The first DP&S building was put up in 1884. And what you see there is the 1900 part. And then later on, they went and added a section in the middle, on the far left, and then they finally got rid of the old 1884 building and made it one big building. But as you went, you walked through that store, especially as you went southward, you noticed that there were differences in levels. You had to sort of watch here and there as you walked. And that's the base, that's the street level of Pomeroy's. The year was 1901. The picture was taken by Jonathan Woods, a commercial photographer in Reading. Now, you see those vaulted windows that you see there when you go back? Those are the windows that had been covered over with that 1950-ish sort of modern facade. In Pomeroy's, in the days when most of those stores had a clerk at virtually every table, I remember that Five and Dimes, there'd be somebody behind every counter.
Service.
Yeah, a service. Yeah. Today you have to go in with a divining rod to find someone to win.
And a lasso.
Okay, we're going to come back to this one later. Very, very rare picture. That was a glass tinted stereo view. Look at the Schuylkill Canal on the other side, the Reading side, and the old hotel also had been a mill early on. We're looking from West Reading over into Reading.
What flood did we lose that one in?
Well, we didn't lose it. Well, 1850 we lost it. And then there was a flood of 1869 that did a little damage, but not too much. And it was taken away in 1884 when they pulled the Pennsylvania Railroad on the Reading side. Mm. And they thought it was not a good idea to take a railroad locomotive beneath a wooden bridge.
That's an awesome bridge.
Isn't that neat? Isn't that a great picture?
That's a really great picture.
Someone lent me that glass stereoptic and picture for 4 hours and wanted it back. I made 9 copies. Okay, let's switch over.
We're going to take a multimedia switch here and introduce our other guest here. One of the busiest county offices in the services center opposite the courthouse is the Recorder of Deeds. In recent times, many improvements in the quality of service have been brought about by the current Recorder of Deeds, Mr. Fred Sheeler. It is our pleasure to have Mr. Sheeler with us this evening to take some time to show us in our audience the workings of his office and how it impacts homeowners and benefits historians and genealogists on a daily basis. Mr. Sheeler?
Thank you very much. What I'd like to give you a quick view of is our website. And if we could bring, yes, we have that up there. This is at countyofberks.com. If you want to jump right to it, you can put a forward slash and then the word recorder, and that'll take it right to our page. And you see, we start you off with a nice view of some of the oldest deeds and mortgages that we have in our collection. We have some of the actual original documents. What we have in our recordings from about 1752 up until the 1950s are actual transcriptions of those documents, where the recorder at first started to handwrite the documents, and then about 1900 or so, it started to be typewritten, and then by the 50s, it was an actual microfilm copy. So you had actually almost like a photocopy. So what you would do here to start to access some of the records is click on where it says search records online, and that takes you to a little explanation page and kind of gives you a rundown of what's contained in the site at this point. What we have in here are images of the deeds. We're working at it from both ends, the earliest deeds and then the most recent. The earliest deeds we have imaged and indexed from the actual documents from 1752 up to about 1772 so far. And they're indexed to the point where you can type in that property owner's name and pop up that actual deed.
Searchable.
Our current work goes back to 1975 as far as being able to type the name in and get right to that particular document. So what we do here is just click here to search. I'll just expand that. What you would do at home, if you can get a view of the website now, is you're going to want to create a new user account, which is very simple. You just follow along the pages and you'll create your own user account, and then you can go back into it time and time again. There's no charge to access any of the records. There's only a charge if you want to print a document. It's the standard state rate of 50 cents per page. Online, you can do that by credit card. Let me just go into the...
Hopefully your password doesn't come up over the years.
You
would be in a heap of trouble.
Okay. And then there's some announcements here. It just tells you what's up to date, what's in the site. And most people want to go to search public records. And just to give you an example of some of the things that we've stumbled across as we've indexed these things. Let me type in, I thought this one was really interesting, Reading Fair. We came across the original charter from the Penns establishing the Reading Fair and the Reading Farmers Market back in 1767. So you see, that's the first document on the top. It was recorded in April 4th of 1767. You just click on where it says document number. Let me see here. I should have checked this.
Does the initial search come up in date order, Fred?
Yeah, it will come up in date order.
Okay.
Apparently, we don't have
Java
installed on this computer. Should have checked that first. I don't know if we have any computer people here. But unfortunately, I won't be able to show you that online. But I do have it on paper form.
So it shows the whole...
You'll be able to see the actual document. Online.
And that's really very clear. I'm really impressed.
Yeah,
really clear.
The scanned images come out just as good as the actual.
I think they're better.
Somewhat, because the actual deed books have yellowed over time. The ink has turned brown, and there's not a lot of contrast.
And that was splendid.
That's why the old microfilm did not work as well, because there wasn't enough contrast between the yellow paper and the brown ink.
Mm-hmm.
But just to show you the one from the Reading Fair, we can kind of get this.
That's amazing. This. It'll be do anything about
like
that.
A close-up one.
Back when penmanship meant something,
sorry.
Too.
Well, they had a lot more time to write.
we'll get this. Okay.
It did much
sorry we couldn't get it on the actual.
Can we get there? Oh, the camera's there.
Oh, there it is.
Okay. On the website, you'll be able to zoom in on parcels of it, expand it, blow it up. And if you want a good copy, you can just contact our office, and we can print it on large format. You can print it at home on you know, your regular size printer. But what's interesting about this document was that it stated that the citizens of Reading were desirous of a market to sell merchandise and goods, and for fairs to sell cattle and other wares. And Thomas Penn and Richard Penn were found that they were in agreement with the desires of the citizens, and they decided to allow these fairs to be held in October and June of each year, two times a year, and the Penn Square Market to be held on Wednesdays and Saturdays each week. And they actually appointed the clerk of the market. Mm-hmm. And you can see on the website, if you want to go back to the website, fortunately can't see the images, but the clerk of the market, his name is Henry Haller, and he was appointed by the Penns to serve as the clerk. Some of the other documents I brought along here are commissions. This one is in our book one. We can switch back to the view if we can get a quick glance of the actual document. This is book one, page 300, and it's an actual commission from King George II, King Defender of the Faith, King of Britain, France, and Ireland. I don't know if France really agreed with that at the time. But this was establishing the commissions of the first Berks County officers. James Reed was the first recorder, and there was other justices of the county.
James Reed held quite a number of offices.
Yes, I've seen
that. He was a busy fellow.
Yeah, and so far in our records, he was recorder or a justice of the county for at least 20 years. Mm-hmm. He's on all the deeds from 1752 to 1772. So
I think
far.
He held something like three or four row offices.
Yeah, I believe they are actually originated where some of the counties have ended up in Pennsylvania now, where mm-hmm. in some of the states right. that have a home rule charter, they have one person that does all the row offices. Mm-hmm. I don't agree with that, because I like being recorded. So.
Well, you're doing a great job,
Fred. Thank you. Thank you very
much. I'm really
much.
Impressed.
Right now, you can see about 90% of every page of deeds that ever was recorded in Berks County on the website.
How many deeds is that for you?
Yeah. I don't have the exact number. It was every over 5,000 deed books.
Okay. 5,000 deed books?
Deed books, which started out at about 600, 650 pages per deed, and then by 1987, we're up to about 2,500 pages per deed book. At that time, they really aren't deed books anymore. There's rolls of microfilm.
Mm-hmm.
We did away with most of the microfilm so far in just the last 6 to 8 months. We've converted it all to digital image, so it's accessible on the website.
That's
as
wonderful.
Long as you have Java installed on your computer, then you can see it. By the end of this summer, we'll have every single deed available on the website, and you'll be able to search in two methods. We're indexing by names up to the 1770s. We hope to take it at least up to 1787, to the actual date of the Constitution. And then we're working backwards. We're in 1975 now on the earlier things. We're going to get that back to the 60s. In between there, we're going to fill that in with, I don't know, George, if you remember the Russell Index books in our office. That's a system where the deeds were filed.
Oh, a strange system.
In a phonetic
In a phonetic,
system.
Yeah.
You use just the letters LMNRT.
Right.
And it's a great way of...
Oh, those big index books that
yeah,
you speak. Okay.
Of finding a name, not knowing the spelling at all.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can misspell a name, and you're still going to find it. Well, we found a way to bring that in a digital format. So those books that are about 200 of these books, physical books located in our office, which only one person could really look at a time, can be viewed online by thousands of people at once.
I've forgotten about that unusual system.
So it's going to simplify it, because you used to have to take your name, look at the letters that were just L, M, N, R, T, use two of those, plus the first initial of the person's given name, and that would take you to a section of a book. And then you'd have to physically go to that section. Now you just type in the name, and the first initial of the first name, and it'll bring you the group of pages of that book.
Wow.
And you just have to scan through the pages, and you'll find your name.
Fantastic.
So it's coming along quite well, and we think by the end of this summer we'll have all that available.
That's good
news for you.
We're working with a company that handles our computer system. It's called Record Fusion.
Okay.
They're from Newcastle, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
They now have Montgomery County. They will soon have Lancaster and Chester, so we'll have a big swath of southeastern Pennsylvania on one system. And they have probably about 30, 40 counties throughout the United States. And they take our records, digitize them, and make them in a searchable format. And it's actually at a much lower cost than the previous system had been. So we're saving money as well.
And offering more greater service.
That's what we're trying to. We have an effort in our office to supply excellent customer service. So if you're not great with a computer, all you have to do is call us or stop into the office, and we have plenty of staff members who will help you out and find what you need.
That's great.
That is great.
It really is.
Thank
you so much for
your welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And we're looking forward to a visit again.
Sure. I'd be glad to come back.
Thank you. Let's see. Joshua.
Yes, George.
Did you bring us something to look at tonight?
I always like to bring a few goodies. The museum collections are really pushing forward with their inventory and photography. Photography is a sort of a slow process. Actually, these will be the first two things photographed tomorrow before I put them back in storage. So we're always looking for help with photography, with inventory, and we're always looking for help with the museum and the library, and also the gift shop and our special events. These, one of my favorite objects in the collection is a WPA colonial era model, circa 1800, I think it is, George, of a downtown running that's upstairs on our second floor. If you haven't seen it, you need to see it. It's a historical depiction, circa 1800 of Reading, 5th and Penn, and a couple of the blocks right around 5th and Penn, including the original county courthouse, was right at the intersection of 5th and Penn.
And the last building to survive that was in that thing was the Forrest Shoe Store building.
That's right.
Yeah.
Marks John Biddle's house.
That is a WPA model. Same thing with these two right there. We have more than 200 WPA pieces in the collection, ranging from the very big of that WPA model of downtown Reading to this little model right here. Most of you in the area might be able to guess this building, which is George Washington's headquarters at Valley Forge, which is now part of the National Park Service site down there at Valley Forge. The building to the left, which also has similar writing onto it, is the Conrad Weiser Homestead. Now, I haven't been able to figure out how many buildings, these are plaster, by the way, you could probably tell from the chimneys, which don't last very well. These are plaster. I'm not sure how many buildings they ever made, but from what I've been able to gather, they made buildings throughout the country. Native American dwellings in New Mexico. One of the bigger ones that I have ever seen is Independence Hall in Philadelphia. It took about 10 separate pieces to put together to make the Independence Hall site. But we have maybe about two dozen of them. The Conrad Weiser Homestead is the only one we have for Berks County. We have a number of other southeastern Pennsylvania ones. We have one of Fort Necessity, which was out near Harrisburg, I believe. So we have a number of these. I think they're just absolutely wonderful WPA models. And when you consider the time that went into them, these are all plaster casts, and these are all hand-painted, too. If you look at the individual brickwork and the masonry, these are all hand-colored, hand-tinted stones.
They were glad to have the work.
Well, I think what makes it so interesting is, you know, the WPA didn't just build projects like Skyline Drive and things like that. They had artist and a writer's group portion of the WPA that, you know, that functioned as well.
These are labeled on the back. I'll do something quick here real quick. It says WPA Museum Extension Project, Harrisburg, number 5, I think, is the district in the state, I believe. If anybody knows anything more about these, or how many models they would have made. I understand their goal was to try to get some of these in every school and every museum in the country. Don't think they ever made that goal, but we got some really neat models. We had a bunch of them on display about a couple of years ago.
and I'm finding more WPA models. We even have WPA models of scale furniture based on originals at Effort and Cloister. I just found that the other day while progressing that inventory. So
what were the drawings that we used in the, what exhibit was that?
We also have, yeah, Simon's right, we also have drawings. We have drawings of clothing that they would have worn, but also we have some old...
Tinsmith, was it tinsmith or hinges?
Yeah, we have hinges.
Yeah.
We have old hardware. We even have some drawings of like undershot and overshot water wheels.
Okay.
Like early industry applications that they would have done, documented door hardware, locks, hinges, handles, what have you.
You know, the time passes, because we can't even remember what was in that, and I've only been here 3 years.
But we, and like I said, we have more than 200 pieces of WPA stuff. It's a really neat collection.
Mm-hmm. Si, before we switch back to some slides, anything you want to add? Don't you want to say a few words about the possibility of getting some volunteers for the library?
That we are in desperate need of manpower for the Henry Janssen Library. We're in a fortunate position. When we opened the Henry Janssen Library back on November 11th, 2008, we knew it would be well received, we just didn't know how well received it would be, and it really has. We've over doubled our attendance at the Henry Janssen Library. Every day we get in the neighborhood of, I would say, 11 to 15 patrons who come specifically to Berks County just to use the genealogical and historical research material that we house there. But it really has put a put us in a tough position as far as volunteers and help. We have Kimberly Richards, who is our archivist, director of archives and libraries for the Historical Society, and then we also have Tiffany Fisk-Watts, who is her assistant librarian. Unfortunately, we have our second assistant librarian is out on sick leave, as are a couple of our other volunteers. So this is very interesting work. If you have ever, if you been interested or thought you're interested in genealogical research or historical research, I can tell you that you would be well served to come and talk to Tiffany and to Kimberly about a position at the Historical Society. We're pretty flexible on the hours, but we can, like I said, accommodate you as far as your schedule is concerned. You just have to have computer literacy, because we do need that, be able to use the word processing, Microsoft Word, that type of thing.
And we can show them how.
And just, yeah, we they can, Kimberly can show you how, as can the other assistant librarians. But we'd love to have you come out and talk to Kimberly about a position there. Just give us Kimberly a call, Kimberly Richards, at 610-375-4375, and we can get set up.
Computer databases, everybody loves them, keyword search.
Right.
I'm sure Fred can agree that databases are only as good as the information that goes into
right.
it, and that is quite...
Good stuff in, good stuff out.
Good stuff in.
Yeah, and the neat thing about volunteering at the Historical Society in whatever capacity, and particularly the library, is that if it's not busy, it'll give you plenty of time to look at what materials are there. We have over 18,000 photographs, and it's fascinating just pouring through those things to see what's there, so that not only will you help the people who come in who require assistance, but during downtimes you can, you know, enjoy yourself looking to see what's there, going through the books, the records. It's astounding what we've acquired in just the last couple of years. The collection has virtually doubled.
Yep.
And just two of the many benefits of being a volunteer as well, you get free pretzels and you also get an invite to our annual volunteer dinner.
Yeah, as long as you have 10 hours in, you got to put at least 10 hours in a year.
But 10 hours goes very, very quickly.
No, it really does.
Well, thank you. Let's switch back to some more pictures. Okay. As I said, that bridge, the first bridge opened about 1818. It was a wooden bridge, and along came the freshet of 1850, and washed out all the bridges in Berks County. It was like one of those, like the domino effect. Mm-hmm. You know, the one up at Hamburg let loose, and bang, 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 all the way down the line. The flood of 1869 did some damage to our bridges as well. But this picture was taken probably about 1870, 1871, 72. This was a double lane bridge. We had double lane bridges at Penn Street and at Lancaster Avenue or Bingham Street. In 1869, one-third of the Bingham Street Bridge washed away. It went down the river, and they got on a telegraph line to Douglasville and said, part of a covered bridge is coming down the river. So they got grappling hooks and everything else, and they pulled it out of the river, and Douglasville got a free bridge, and they put it up because people used to wonder why in the world, way out of nowhere, did they have a double lane bridge? And the answer was, well, they didn't build it there; they fished it out of the Schuylkill from Lancaster Avenue.
Can I ask a silly question?
Yes.
How did they get past this bridge?
How'd you run?
How did that bit of the Buttonwood Street Bridge get past this bridge?
Well, in 1850, the Penn Street Bridge was knocked off. This is the second wooden Penn Street Bridge.
What year was the Buttonwood Street Bridge knocked off and given to Douglasville?
Well, the Bingham Street Bridge.
Oh, Bingham.
That was 69. That's to the right of this. This was just south of this
bridge. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
It was the one-third of the Reading side.
Oh, I'm sorry, okay.
Yeah, it was a three-section bridge, and the one-third closest to Reading washed down the river. They hauled it out.
Long way to wash.
Yeah, that's Dr. Benson's steam grist mill that you see on the right-hand side. And you can see what happened during times of flooding, what it did to canal travel. Because you can imagine, just looking at that picture, what would happen during times of flood.
Which flood, in Ben Bernhardt's book on Agnes, there's a photo of the same bridge, and that building right there is flooded to the top story. Which flood was that, do you know?
69.
69, okay.
Yeah, that was a bad flood. Oh, yeah, there are pictures of that.
It's up to the top.
Yep, Dr. Benson's right.
Not quite to the attic, but up to the top story window.
Now,
there,
you see this, the towpath. That towpath widened out as you went down a little bit, mm-hmm. and when they dug the canal from Reading's waterfront, they created an island downstream, and that was Long Island and Reading. When the Keystone Fire Company was first established, they established it on the island as the Keystone Hook and Ladder Company of Long Island, Reading, Pennsylvania. That was the original name, but there were people who actually lived on the island just downstream a short distance. But that's a very, very rare picture. Sam, you remember this.
West Reading Hotel, yeah, sure.
That was the only landmark along the old turnpike in this general locality, and they tore it away. And today that would be like the entranceway to that little strip business there in West Reading,
dry cleaners are and stuff?
Yeah,
In the parking lot where they write on. But now, would that have been the one that would have been there in the 50s, early 60s?
Yeah.
Oh, it was?
Yeah, we used to go there. The teachers used to, why I'm missing, used to go there for lunch once in
and
a while.
When did they tear that one down?
It's been gone a long time. They tore that down when they built that supermarket, whatever it is today, behind that building. Straight behind that, what is it? What's in there today?
I think it's a Rite Aid drugstore.
Okay, well, it was originally a Market supermarket.
Yeah, that was an Acme, but I thought that Acme had been there since the 60s or
50s. It was behind that.
Oh, yeah, okay, all right. So that was, there used to be a Bear Street.
That's been going long, because I went over to Why Missing in 66, and it wasn't that much longer.
I wouldn't think so, yeah.
That they tore that away.
That's right.
That's been going for quite a while.
They used to have a bearskin rug above the bar.
Like Toby's.
Hanging on the wall.
Yeah, like Toby's. They had all kinds of heads all around that place. Yeah, that's unfortunate. And to the left of that was a movie theater, a Nickelodeon movie theater off to the left. There's a picture of that.
Is that the dance studio? That's the dance studio today, isn't
no,
it?
No, that's gone.
Oh.
What's that place called?
Fred Astaire's Dance?
No, that would be on the other
okay.
corner. Oh, that restaurant.
Now, wait a minute.
There's another one over at the Reading, at the fairgrounds.
Oh, Chef Allen's.
Chef Allen's. Yeah. Chef Allen's would be where the florist shop was.
Right.
And that would be part of the parking lot. And that was built as a movie theater, and then later on it functioned as an Olivet boys club, and then they tore it away. But that was the West Reading movie theater that preceded the Penn Theater. I'm sure some of the people will remember this. That was a store over there. This is coming into Sinking Spring. McDonald's would lie off to the left. And that is that Mull or Hull Avenue. I always forget which one that is. The church was an evangelical church that was torn away. There's a notary on that site today. And that general store and whatever has been torn away a long time ago. They used to sell gas. I always have, whenever I come down that hill to the traffic light near McDonald's, I think to myself, can you imagine parking there today to get gas at that site? you would be launched into...
That location is absolutely horrible.
Well, that's, today that's awful.
Even early afternoon, it's not pretty.
Yeah, McDonald's would be off to the left-hand side and right across the street.
Right?
Yeah, coming into that. Mm-hmm. Right across the street from that evangelical church, by the way, the cemetery for that congregation is just up the hill on the left-hand side. And off to the left was the old eight-sided schoolhouse at Sinking Spring, torn down in 1958.
Now, where is that?
Oh, sure. That building still stands. You go out State Hill Road I guess they don't call it Cacoozing anymore. But after State Hill Road, you cross the Cacoozing Creek on the State Hill Road, and it would be just beyond the gas station where you would turn left to go into Sinking Spring. You go beyond that, and that building still stands as a private home. That was the Cacoozing Hotel, and there was a post office there at one time.
Yeah, I know.
Now, the trees are gone. I'm just trying to picture, is that porch there anymore? But that was the Cacoozing Hotel, right where the Cacoozing Creek passes beneath. The State Hill Road. I sort of forgotten about this picture. That's a rarity. That does appear in one of the passing scene books. I look at those pictures like that and it scares me because I took those pictures.
Mm.
That's the Gruber Wagon Works when it was still in Pleasant Valley. The old hotel where the Grubers had lived and where some of the workers in later years stayed as a place to live, like a boarding house. That's the old Burnville Road that you see there. It tends to be wider today.
A little wetter.
Yeah, that's the old Burnville Road. And the new Burnville Road, of course, paralleled it. This picture was taken from the new Burnville Road looking down into the Gruber Wagon Works. I remember we were all astounded when they mentioned about moving the Gruber Wagon Works out to the Grings Mill area. We thought that would be virtually impossible, but they certainly did accomplish that. The meetings were held, by the way, at the Historical Society for that project.
Hmm. Hotel didn't survive, did it?
No. Nothing survives there. Okay, now... this is Pleasant Valley Road, I think. You went back Pleasant Valley Road, they went right in front of the old hotel building, the Gruber House later, and it brought you, you would be coming from the far side up to where the camera position is. That picture I took too, and that was quite a while back. That's the Pleasant Valley Rolling Mill. The Weidenheimers had operated that. That was originally operating on water power, and the Union Canal ran right behind there. That was one of those rolling mills that give you a higher quality flour than just the old-time grist mills with the millstones. That was a rolling process. And that operated up to the time of what locals called unaffectionately that dam project, the Blue Marsh Dam Project. So that was torn down to make way. And there was a Union Canal lock just a short distance away in the background there on the left-hand side. And the home for the mill was on the right-hand side. We would be looking towards the Gruber Wagon Works.
I guess if you wanted to put a positive spin on it, you could say the lock is still holding water.
That's a very, very rare picture. That's the Charming Forge Grist Mill at Charming Forge. When you come down the hill, you can see where the place actually stood, but there's not a thing left. Not even a stone of the foundation that I can remember at Charming Forge. Charming Forge, you would go up that hill and continue like a block or so, and on the right-hand side would be the Charming Forge Mansion.
On the right-hand side?
On the right-hand side, going up the hill.
Wouldn't you be going down the hill at that point?
Well, you would come down the hill from the mansion. You come down that hill to the mill.
Okay.
That's a very rare picture. I've only ever seen one view of that. That was taken, I think, by Michael Gruber, 1911, something like that. Oh, that's the Charming Forge Bridge.
Looks like we have a home viewer, George.
Oh, we have a home viewer. Yes, home viewer. Home viewer, you're on.
Greetings from Exeter, PA, Mr. Miser.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir. Quick question for us in two parts. About 2 years ago, you had started an effort to find the underground passageway or tunnel, if you will, up Penn Street?
Kind of diagonally, yes.
Yes, and I recollect the reasons why you gave up on that when you had taken Mayor McMahon with you on that tour.
Yes.
I wanted to know if you're going to renew those efforts before you and I both pass, and what might we be looking forward in the future of any findings on that?
Well, you know, they closed it off of the Pauline's Soup side, and when they tore down the Forest Shoe Store building, that was the end of entrance to that passageway. Albert Boscov and Amy Walt Johnson, was it Tad Kastner and I, went down in the basement to try to get into that, and it was bricked off.
Yes, I'm aware of that. I was there myself, sir.
Oh, okay.
And there are other avenues, I think, that you could explore yet if you're going to renew your efforts, or if maybe that's a lost cause you're going to write off.
I can't believe that isn't still, part of that still isn't there, because we didn't, oh, listen, we have to go. I've just gotten the red flag.
Very good.
Call us another time and give us a buzz at home.
I enjoy your show. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Tell your friends about our show, which is on the first Wednesday of each month at 7. Thanks to today's program associates, Joshua Blay, Simon Bertlett,
thank you, George.
Bob Cooper, who just left us, and Fred Sheeler, who's doing wonderful work at the Recorder of Deeds office. I'm George Miser, your host and president of the Historical Society. We look forward to having you join us again on Wednesday, July 1, 2009, the first day of July. Thanks for watching. So long.
Society on BCTV is supported in part by the Highlands at Wyomissing.